good evening, good evening, good evening, good evening. Good evening. Good evening. Good evening. Let me make this disclaimer. The music that you're hearing is not our own. The music that you are hearing, we are not the writer, the songwriter. This is not our own music. Let me make this disclaimer before I begin. We did not produce, nor are we singing. And so therefore, we do not own the rights to this music. Come on in. Good evening, good evening, good evening. Amen. How many today know that I never would have made it? If we are listening to the instrumental of Marvin Sapp, like I say, we do not own the rights to this music. And therefore, we're not the songwriter. Good evening, Sister Cole. Amen. We are not the songwriter. And so, Facebook, please be kind to us. Amen. As we are listening to the instrumental. Amen. We praise God this afternoon that all of us understand that we never would have made it if it had not been for the Lord on our side. And so today I just kind of felt led to listen to a little bit of the instrumental of Dr. Marvin Sapp. Come on in, come on in, come on in. I'm so grateful to be here this afternoon. Amen. It seems like forever since we have been together. But God is gracious. God is kind. He is so merciful. And with all of those that I've just said, he is certainly good all the time. And so I'm so grateful to be here this afternoon once again. Come on in. It is that moment, that time. I know tonight I'll be competing with the NBA playoff, but amen. We ought to want a word before we sit down and take in our festivities. It is Wednesday night. It is Wednesday night. It is Wednesday night. It is Wednesday night. It is time for worship through the word. Amen. Worship through the word of God on this Wednesday night. It seems like forever. And I am grateful to be here tonight. How many know that I never would have made it? There were some things that I went through, and I didn't think I was going to get through them. But it was in the moments of my despair. It was in the moments of my troubles. It was in the moments of me feeling like all is lost that God showed up. If that's your testimony, then I just need you to type on the screen, amen. Because the Bible said he is a present help in the times of trouble. God shows up in the midst of our storm. And sometimes he does not take you out of your storm, but he simply walks you through your storm. Somebody ought to shout, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I don't have to fear. For thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And so tonight, we are grateful that we understand how we made it. We understand the purpose that God has on our life. Sister Carlisle, Sister Goff, we understand that we got through every storm because of God, because of his love for us. And so tonight, I am so grateful, amen, to be with you tonight. Look here, let me say this before we even dive into what we're going to look at tonight. Show you what the power of prayer will do. And I'm asking for all of our believers to be praying with me. Wednesdays are normally my heaviest days. For whatever reason, it's just the trick of the enemy. It just has worked out. Wednesday has been the day that it takes me the longest to finish, to get back home. And so Two Wednesdays ago, we had to cancel Bible study because I didn't get home to a little after 5 o'clock. And so it would have been rush to try to sit down. And then last week, of course, I was in the last seven sayings of Christ on the cross. But still, even in that, I was rushing to get there because of last minute. But Monday, I began to pray and ask God to be gracious towards me, give me favor on my Wednesday. And I asked him again on Tuesday morning during my meditational moments to be gracious to me on Wednesday. And then even this morning, I was in my meditation and I was praying, asking God for favor for Wednesday, because I desire to be here and to do what you have called me to do, and that is to teach your holy word. And y'all, today I was finished at like 11 o'clock this morning, really like 10 o'clock. And I was like, look at God. And so God deserves all the honor and glory. And I'm asking y'all to be praying with me that Wednesdays will be my lightest day instead of my heaviest days. Amen. So that we can continue to study God's word. Look, tonight, I want to talk about hope. And that was the purpose of me playing Never Would Have Made It. Because there's so many of us who have gone through trials and tribulation. And there's so many people that during this season that we are in right now, because we're still in a season of testing, there's so many who have just about given up hope. There's so many feel like hope is lost. And then there's so many, the prayer list really is steady growing, because there's so many people who are going through. Sister Martin is in the hospital, and certainly we're praying for her. And you know, there's so many. My niece, we were on the prayer line the other day praying for my niece, Ashley. And there's so many in the body of Christ that even belong to New Bethel Missionary Baptist Church who we are praying for, who are going through at this time, at this moment. We certainly thank God for our very own Sister May's daughter, who I believe was released from hospital on Tuesday. But you know, there's been so much death and everything. And so I came on tonight to just really encourage you with the passage of scripture that is very familiar and that is quoted a lot, but it's not necessarily studied a lot. And that is Jeremiah chapter 3, verses 22 through 24, I believe it is, that we're going to look at today. One of the things that I want us to grasp tonight is the fact that God cares about you. God cares about you. And so even in the midst of your going through, God cares about you. Watch this. Okay. In this pericope about that Jeremiah writes, it seems like everyone longs for hope. And in this pericope, because of it was one of the darkest hours in the history of Judah. But God sends a message through his messenger. And that's the same thing for us today. It's in our most darkest moments. The Bible said, he that have an ear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord has to say to the church. And it's in our darkest moment that we have to shut out all outside noise and distractions. Because the enemy speaks the loudest in our darkest moments. The enemy wants you to believe that there is no hope, that God does not care about you. The enemy wants you to believe that you're going to die. Amen. But the word of God said, you shall live and not die and declare his word. But the enemy speaks the loudest when we are in our darkest moments of despair. The enemy will come and tell you that you might as well give up. But I came to tell you, don't ever lose your hope in God. And so it is. At this time that Judah is going through a dark time, Sister Williams, and even in the midst of destruction, watch this, Jeremiah recorded these inspiring words of solid hope. And that's the same thing that Jeremiah is doing for us today. Because the Bible lets us know in Romans 15 and 4, the Bible lets us know that whatever was written before is written for us today as well. And I'm paraphrasing. And so here it is in Jeremiah chapter 3, verse number 1. Jeremiah is sitting. Let me just set the stage and then we're going to get into this thing. Jeremiah is sitting in a cave overlooking Jerusalem. And he weeps as he sees the rubble of the one of this once glorious city that men call the perfection of beauty. He smells the stench of decaying bodies. He sees poor, starving people poking through the rubble. This is a dark picture. Amen. And sometimes in our life, we feel like our lives have reached the same plateau as these people's lives have reached. The Bible lets us know that pride leads to destruction and a haughty spirit leads to a fall. In other words, what we see are people being punished by God for their disobedience. But even in God's punishment, there's still love. God's punishment is wrapped in love. Any of us who have ever been in trouble understand that our parents used to always tell us, you know, I'm doing this because I love you. The sad part of the tragedy is that all of this could have been averted. Because Jeremiah tells them in 18:11, go warn all of Judah and Jerusalem. This is what the Lord says. And I'm planning disaster for you instead of good. This is what happens in our life when sometimes we allow outside distractions cause us to take our eye off God and we began to become stagnant. Amen. God has a way of allowing storms, afflictions, amen, financial trouble, whatever, relational troubles to cause us to refocus so that we can get back into the right standing, the right position, the right status with God, because God loves us so much. And so he says to these people who are going through hell in high water, he says, watch this, in verse 22, he says, well, verse 21, let me go there. He says, this I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope. In other words, watch this. Jeremiah basically cease thinking about himself. And that's the key to us retaining our hope on tonight. This is the key. Sometimes you got to look beyond what you're going through. I know it's hard. I know it's easier for me to say than for you to do. But sometimes you got to look beyond where you are right now and think about what God has done for you in the past. And then you have to encourage yourself to say, if God done it before, if he done it in my life before, he can do it again. And so he ceased thinking about himself and the situation. And watch this. He starts thinking about God. That's why the Bible said that he'll keep you in perfect peace if your mind is stayed on thee. When I think of his goodness, amen. And all that he's done for me, watch this. My soul cries out. Then the psalmist said, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually to be in my mouth. So the Bible says that in verse 22, it is the Lord, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. So in other words, get this, watch this. No matter what you're going through, no matter how dark it gets, no matter how alone you feel, no matter how much you feel like God has left you, there's solace in this text because, watch this, if God didn't love you, then what you were going through would have taken you out. We've been dealing with a pandemic for over 2 years, but it's because of God's love for us that we are still him. Those of us who have experienced, the infection of COVID and still sitting here, still able to be here on God's green earth, we understand that it was God's love that kept us. And so the Bible says, it is of the Lord's mercy that you are, that we are not consumed. God loves you too much to allow what you're going through to take you out. There's a reason you're still here. That's why we can give God praise in spite of our situation, because we understand that I might not feel my best right now, but I understand that God has been keeping me. That's why I love when the choir sings the song, I want you to know that God has been keeping me. Then there's another song, Sister Kane, that said, oh, to be kept by Jesus. So it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. Watch this. The word mercies, it comes from a word in Hebrew that means that it sounds like chased. It's cheesed. It's C-H-E-S-E-D. And in Hebrew, it means, watch this, kindness or love of God towards humanity. In other words, it's favor. You want to know why what you've been going through, what the enemy meant for bad, and God is turning around for your good? It's because of the favor God has on your life. When God favors you, that means that everything God purposed and planned for your life is going to work out for the better for you. It also means, watch this, God's mercies, it means God's faithfulness. Oh, God, I bless your wonderful name. How many today are glad that in spite of sometimes me losing a step in my march in the army of the Lord, God is still always faithful? Amen. His mercies, they that we are not consumed. It is the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. Watch this. The word consume, to do away with completely. So in other words, the enemy that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Your hater that wants to see you fail. Amen. The family member that is hating on you and stabbing you in your back. The friend that have let you down time and time again. God does not allow you to be consumed. In other words, he does not do away with you completely. So in other words, everything that you've gone through is there to tear you down. God used it to build you up. So it is the love of mercy that we are not consumed. Watch this. Because his compassions fail not. The word compassion means love. His mercy. So in other words, because he loves you so much, what you have been dealing with cannot destroy you. That's a word for somebody. What you are dealing with cannot destroy you because God's love. In other words, it means that God is gracious towards us. Okay, let's get some Bible. Let's look at 2 Timothy 2 and 13. 2 Timothy 2 and 13. Watch this. Watch this. Watch this. Watch this. Let's start at verse 12. Watch this. It says, if we endure, we will also reign with him. Let's back up one. Verse 11 says, this saying is trustworthy. If we died with him, we shall also live with him. Watch this. Verse 12. If we endure, I'm reading from New English Translation, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, watch this, he will also deny us. So in other words, what the writer is saying here in 2 Timothy is basically, as long as we stay with God, watch this, God will stay with us. Amen. But watch this in verse 13. Don't miss this. He says, if we are unfaithful, which means that if for some reason I give up on God, for some reason I turn my back on God, Pastor Salisbury, for some reason, because of what I'm going through, what I've been dealing with, because I've lost a loved one, and now I've blamed the death on God, saying that God does not love me, and so I give up on God. Verse 13 says, if we are unfaithful, watch this, he remains faithful. Oh, God, I bless your wonderful name. So in other words, even when I give up on God, God does not give up on me. That's why the Bible said that his desire is for none to perish, but all to come to a place of repentance. God desires us so much and loves us so much that he's willing, watch this here, to allow his mercies to show up in our lives daily. So he says, if we're unfaithful, he remains faithful. Watch this. Since he cannot deny himself. So in other words, the Spirit of God that lives on the inside of us, that is the promise from God that we will receive eternal life. Watch this. He remains faithful to himself. He cannot deny himself. So if the Spirit of the Lord lives in me, he remains faithful to the Spirit of God that is on the inside of me. So in other words, he remains faithful to us. Woo, don't miss that. Anybody glad that God is faithful? Even when you are unfaithful, I know sometimes we mess up. God remains faithful. I know sometimes we get in a place where sometimes we become slothful, we become lazy, but God remains faithful. I know sometimes, you know, some days are not as easy as other days, but God remains faithful. I don't know about you, but I'm glad I serve a faithful God. How do I know he was faithful? Because just last Sunday, we saw his faithfulness when he went to the cross and got up out of the grave with all power in his hand. He could have saved himself, but the Bible said, in the garden he decided, not my will, but your will be done. And so he remains faithful. Amen. Let's look at another scripture. Hebrews 10 and 23. Hebrews 10 and 23. Let's go there real quick. I'm not going to try to be too long tonight. Watch this. Verse 10 and 23 says in Hebrew, let us hold unwaveringly to the hope that we confess. The hope that you confess. What is the hope that you confess? I confess that the Lord Jesus Christ is not only my Savior, he's my Redeemer, he's my way maker, he's my bridge over troubled water, he's my way out and a way in. He's whatever I need him to be. That's why the psalmist said, God is, and I can stop right there. Whatever you need God to be, that's what he is. So it says, hold unwaveringly. In other words, you need to be solid. Anybody ever had some fakey friends? Some flaky friends? That's a hard word to say. You know, people that you really couldn't put a whole lot of trust in. People that as long as things were solid and going right, you knew they would be there because of the benefit. But as soon as things in your life got a little, shaky, and you looked to them for help, they wasn't nowhere around, or they couldn't be consistent with you the way that you were with them. The Bible is saying, hold unwaveringly to your faith that we confess. We confess we have faith. We confess we have hope. We hope in God. Watch this here. Let me read something to you. Something that I wrote down, if I can find it. Amen. Watch this. It was something I wrote that talked about the fact that hope is not something that we are kind of guessing to happen. But hope is really us trusting in God. That's what it is. Hope is not, there it is right there. Hope is not wishful thoughts. You know, sometimes we can just say, I hope it don't rain tomorrow. Now that's a hopeful thought. You know, that's a wishful thought. Sometimes we can just, you know, I hope tomorrow it don't rain tomorrow. But hope, the real hope, the foundation of what faith is, where you find faith at. Hope is not wishful thought. Watch this. But confident expectation in the Lord. And so when I stand on the hope, It says right there, unwavering to the hope that we confess. When I have the hope that God gives, I am confidently expecting God to do just what he said. And so I'm standing on his promise. Amen, somebody. Because he told me, watch this, in the midst of my storm, he'll never leave me nor forsake me. And so I stand in expectation for him to either stop the storm or bring me out of the rain. Oh, God. So watch this. Let's look at one more, and then we're going to move. I'm going to try not to hold you too long. 1 John chapter 1. Sister Cheryl, tell Brother John I said hello. 1 John chapter 1, verse number 9. Watch this. Let me show you his faithfulness, because that's what we're dealing with right now. God's faithfulness. Amen. God's faithfulness. Watch this here. The Bible said, but if we confess our sins, watch this, oh God, he is faithful and righteous. Watch this. He's faithful. That means that when I mess up, mercy, everlasting to everlasting, whenever you fall short, if you confess our sin, if you confess your sin, the Bible said, he is faithful. God will never turn his back on you. That's why the Bible said that his compassion fell not. There's a reason why you haven't been consumed. Because God's love shows up. It shows up more when we have fallen short. How do I know? Because John 3:16 said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever shall believe in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. So he says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful, watch this, and righteous. Other words, he's a righteous judge. He has the right to judge us. Because he's faithful, he has the right to judge us. But because he's faithful, he looks beyond our faults and saw our need. That's why he sent his son in our place. And so now, when I ask for forgiveness, because he's faithful to the cause, he sees the blood instead of the sin. And so when I ask for forgiveness and I am, sincere, the Bible said he'll forgive us of our sins and cleansing us. Because that's what he does with the word. The word washes us. That's what the word says. And cleansing us from all unrighteousness. The word washes us as well as the blood. Watch this. And both came from the same person. That being Jesus the Christ. Because he is the word. And he did shed his blood. Oh God, I bless your name. Watch this. So consume, to do away with completely. So in other words, Jeremiah was letting us know that no matter how dark it gets, no matter where you are in life, no matter how hard it is because of the Lord's mercies that you have not been totally wiped out. God loves you that much that he has not allowed the thing that has been bothering you, the thing that has been battering you, the thing that has caused you to sometime fall on your knees and buckle over, the thing that has been keeping you up at night, having sleepless night. He said, guess what? It's because of God's love that that thing has not taken you out. Amen. Watch this. I got one more, and then I'm going to move. Let's go to Old Testament. Exodus 33. I love this right here. Exodus 33. Watch this. Moses is with the children of Israel. Notice in verse 1, he said, the Lord says to Moses, go up from him. Woo! Tells them it's time to move. You've been stuck in this position. Oh, this is a word for somebody. You've been stuck where you are for too long. Go up from here. It's time for you to move. You've been holding on to your depression. You've been holding on, to this sadness. You've been in this dark place for a long time. He's saying, watch this. It's time for you to go up from him. You and the people you brought up out of the land of Egypt to the land I promised on an oath to Abraham, Isaac, and the Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendant. So he tells Moses, it's time to move. Minister Archinard, he's saying, it's time now to move from the place where you've been, hanging out for the last 40 years. It's time to move. That's a word. So he says in verse 2, don't miss it. Verse 2, he says, I will send an angel, get this, before you. Y'all know Sunday we was talking about the angel. And I will drive out the Canaanite, the Amorites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, and all of them sites. I'm going to wipe them out. I'm going to send an angel before you. Verse 3 said, go up to a land flowing with milk and honey, but I would not, watch this, because I don't want you to miss this, but I would not go among you, for you are a stiff-necked people, and I might destroy you on the way. So God is saying, I need you to move, but I ain't going with you. I'm going to send a representative. Now, for some folk, they can shout to that because they're saying, we're moving. God going to keep us. Hey, what's better than that? But not Moses. When you have experienced the presence of God, when you have experienced the closeness of God, when you have been in conversation with God, and God has been talking to you, then you don't want no representative of God, but you want to hear from God yourself, himself. So it is, let's drop down to verse 12. So watch this. Moses said, see, you have been saying to me, bring this people up, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Moses saying, you know what? I heard you. You said you're going to send somebody with us, but you ain't told me who going. Because Moses understand the importance of God's presence. Oh, God. But you said, I know you by name. Moses saying, now this is the conversation Moses had with God. Amen. And also, you have found favor in my sight. This is what Moses said. God, this is what you said about me, that I know you by name and I found favor in your sight. Y'all remember Hezekiah, when the word of the Lord came to him and told him, the prophet came and told him that he was going to die. He turned to the wall and said, Lord, you know what? You know my story. You know all the things I've done, and so in his plea to God, God sent word back, told him that he was going to add life to him. He was going to add some more years to his life. So it is. And verse 13 said, now, if I found favor, this is Moses talking, show me your way that I may know you. Moses is saying, I want to know even more about you. That's what our plea should be tonight. If you're going to find hope in your situation, you need to know God on another level. It was Paul that said, watch this here, that I may know you in the power of your resurrection. Paul was a very educated man. But Paul said, you know what? None of that matter. I want to know you on a whole new level. When you know God on another level, then these frivolous things that you're going through won't even bother you. You will laugh and be like Jane, count it all joy. For whenever I fall into divers temptation, amen, because I know it's working my faith. Sometimes we need something to work our faith up. Sometimes God knows what exactly you need, so he'll allow something to happen to cause your faith to stir. And so he says, that I may know you, that I may continue to find favor in your sight, and see this nation is your people. That's what Moses is saying to God. Then he says in verse 14, and the Lord said, my presence. Watch this. Notice that when you take a stance and talk to God about knowing God on a different level, when you take a stance and tell God, I want to know you more intimately. When you take a stance and say, God, I know you say I know your name, and I know you say I've got favor, but God, I need to go to another level with you. Notice he turns around in verse 14, God takes a different stance because he says, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. Verse 15, and Moses said to him, if your presence does not go with us, watch this, do not take us up from him. If God, if you don't go with me, I don't want to move. That should be our stance tonight. We ought to say, God, if you're not going, I ain't going. Because your promise to me is you will be with me always, even until the end. So he says in verse 16, for how would it be known then that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people? It is not by your going with us so that we will be distinguished. Is it not by your going? So in other words, he's saying, if you go with us, people will know who we are. And that's how it is as people of God. When God travels with you because he lives in you, people ought to know that God is on your side. They ought to know that God has favor on your life. There ought to be a light that shines, amen, like this light that's in my glasses tonight. There ought to be a light, a glow that's going. Let's move. Oh God, let me drop on down some more. So in verse 17, the Lord says to Moses, I will do this thing also that you have requested, for you have found favor in my sight. Amen. And I know you by name. It's one thing to know God's name, but it's another thing for God to know your name. Verse 18, and Moses said, show me your glory. Oh, God. Moses had a request. He said, you know what? I don't want to move unless you go with us. And to give me, solace in what you're saying you're going to do, let me see your glory. Verse 19, we're going to stop right there. Verse 19, New English Translation said, and the Lord said, watch this, I will make all of my goodness pass before your face. Hey, God. That's all I'm trying to let you know, that don't lose your hope. Because his compassion fail not, even in your moment where you're getting ready to move and go to a place that you know nothing about and God is leading you because he's ordering your step. He says, watch this, I will make all of my goodness pass by before you. That means God will shield you in the process of transformation. He said, I will proclaim that the Lord by name before you. I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy to whom I will show mercy. But then he adds, he said, you cannot see my face, for no one can see me and live. But verse 21, he says, but the Lord said, here is a place by me. You will station yourself on a rock, and when my glory pass by, I will put you in a cliff in the rock, and I will cover you with my hand. Oh, God. And I will pass by. Then I will take away my hand, and you will see the back of my face, but you will see my back, but not my face will be seen. God knows how to shield us. And so whatever you are dealing with today, whatever you're going through, do not lose hope, because God knows how to shield us from what has been trying to destroy. God knows how to make everything work out for your good. Amen. So let's go back to Jeremiah. Let's go back to our theme scripture. Jeremiah chapter 3. Let's get back there so we can get ready to close out. Jeremiah chapter 3. Let's get there. All right. Watch this. All right, here we go. Jeremiah 22. Oh, my thing changed on me, Lord Jesus. Jeremiah. Lamentations chapter 3. That's why I'm messing up. Amen, I got excited. Watch this. So he says, it is of the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed. God's love causes things that are trying to destroy us not to be able to. Because his compassion, his love, his mercy, watch this, fail not. That word fail simply means, in the Hebrew, Kalah. K-A-L-A-H. Watch this. It means to end or to cease. So in other words, watch this. God's mercies causes us not to come to an end. But because of his love never ceases or ends. There is no end to God's love. So even when we are going through difficult times, I know when we lose loved ones, that is a hurtful time, and that hurt stays with us a long time. But God's love shows up even in those moments, and his love never ends. You have people who have been together 30, 40 years, end up in divorce court or broken up because their testimony is, well, we fell out of love. God loves never ends. How do I know? Let's go to Psalms. Psalm 100. Let's go there real quick. Psalms 100. Get there. Psalms 100. Watch this. Verse 5. We're not going to read all of Psalms 100. Verse number 5. It says, for the Lord is what? Good. And his mercy is everlasting. Y'all get that? His mercy is everlasting. Mercy. His love. His kindness. His faithfulness. His goodness. It is everlasting. There is no end to God's love. And his truth endure to all generation. You want to know why? You still here in spite of all you've gone through? It's because God's love is everlasting. It is from everlasting to everlasting. Amen. Watch this. I wrote this down. Get this. God never changes, even when our love for Christ has changed. Watch this. His love for us will never change. We may give up on God, but God will never give up on us. God's love, watch this, don't miss this. God's love is the only love that knows no end. Sister William, God's love knows no end. It knows no end. That's something to celebrate God right there. That's something to celebrate God right there. Okay, let's go back. Let's finish where we started so we can get out of here. Sister Tammy, it's good to see you. And my brother, Brother Ronnie Salisbury, amen. Watch this. Always good when y'all tap in. Watch this. Don't miss this. And so he says, watch this. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Okay. Now, this is what we're getting ready to end. We're going to end right here. It says, his compassion fail not. They are renewed, or they are new, brand new, every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Watch this. Mercy. Where he says mercies, God's mercy is new every day. The word mercy in the Hebrew is racham, R-A-C-H-U-M. Watch this. And it means, don't miss this, Pastor Salisbury. It means to actively show compassion. Y'all get that? It means, okay, it is of the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed. So in other words, why are we not consumed? Because his compassion fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Mercy. In the Hebrew, it means to actively show compassion. So when we read that, God's mercies, don't miss this. We're going to close here. God's mercies are new every morning, which means the reason why they're new every morning is because he actively show compassion towards us every day. So that means that every morning that he touch you and get you up, He's actively showing you mercy. You know how it is when something you have to activate? Amen. You know, before it is usable, it has to be activated. Amen. God actively activates his mercy on our life every day. So why should I hold on to my hope? Why, like the songwriter said, why should I be discouraged? When Jesus is my portion, a company friend in him, his eyes on the sparrow, and I know he watches over me. That's why you ought to be able to hold on to your hope, because God's love, God's compassion, God's kindness, God's mercy, God's goodness, they are renewed every day. They are actively active towards your life. So no matter what you're going through today, do not lose hope. Do not give up on God. Songwriter said, because he won't give up on you, he's able. But I came to tell you tonight, he's faithful. God is faithful. And I'm so grateful that he is faithful. God bless you. God keep you is my prayer. There are so many people that I can't remember everyone, but let's just be praying for our sick and shut in, those who are afflicted with some type of ailment or illness. Let's keep them lifted in prayer. Amen. We are, as I said earlier, praying for my niece, Sister Ashley, and praying for our membership. Certainly praying for Sister Johnny Martin. Amen. And her family. And keep me lifted as well. Amen. I want to be here on Wednesday nights. And I'm trusting God that things are going to work out for my good. Amen. I'm going to keep hope alive. Amen. Come on, let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you tonight. We bless you, God. We thank you for all that have came on this live, God. And Father, we thank you for what the Spirit has said to the church, God. And God, we thank you for the hope that we have in you. And this is not a hope of wishful thinking, God, but this is a hope of expectation, because we're expecting, God, for something supernatural to happen in our midst, God. Whenever you show up, God, Father, something has to happen. God, we thank you today, God, because for those who have been going through storms and have lost their hope or lost their way or lost their confidence, God, I come to tell them tonight, God, that it's because of your mercies, God, that we have not been consumed. Your love shows up in the most difficult of times. If what we have been dealing with has not taken us out, it's because your love has spared our life. And so we have something today to rejoice about. We have something to bless your name about. We have something, God, to exalt you, because you said if you be lifted up from the earth, you will draw men unto you. God, we just want to tell you thank you. Thank you for your son, Jesus, and what he did on Calvary's cross. God, we have a hope today. We have a hope in Christ. And through Christ, God, that everything is not only going to work out for our good, but it has already been worked out. And so, God, we pray today for our sick and shut in, God, those names that we know and we can't even remember and recall. God, you know everything. To me, they are anonymous, but to you, they are obvious, God. And we pray today, God, that your will and purpose be done in all of our lives. In the mighty name of Jesus, we do pray. God, we're praying for a special move of God on Sunday, God. Show up and show out. In Jesus' name, amen. Look, I love you, and there is nothing that you can do about it. Amen. Look, go in peace. Amen. God bless you. God keep you is my prayer. Amen.